Just a quick program note for those of you who are here for the Donald Trump event with Wounded Warriors. That's actually tomorrow night at Drake University in Des Moines. So, my name is Steve Edwards. I'm the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and we are pleased to have you with us to help sort through and understand what is arguably one of the most unpredictable and fascinating primary election seasons, certainly in the last couple of decades, if not further. This is part of our ongoing series of events that we do at the Institute to try and bring leading thinkers and players in politics to share their insights and experiences with us to help us expand and illuminate the public conversation. We also want to make a quick program note for you as it relates to Iowa that on Wednesday, the day after, so a week from today, the day after the Iowa caucuses, we will be doing a similar conversation, a full recap on the results, what happened and what it means for the race going forward. That will take place at 6 o'clock a week from tonight, Wednesday night, at Ida Noyes, and we have at the table out in the lobby area a sign up for those of you who haven't yet registered. There's an opportunity for you to do so. It's free and open to the public. Tonight's event is on the record. It is being recorded for our IOP website. You can follow all of our public events and go back and watch the back of your head and the rest of our panelists online. You can search for us via iTunes U. You can also find out more about all of our upcoming public events in our ongoing series on our website at politics.uchicago.edu. As is customary here, we'll take a break in the middle of the conversation about three quarters of the way through to get your questions for our panel tonight. We'll put a microphone in the middle of the room here and ask that you stand up single file to prepare your questions. We, of course, want to remind you that we want questions and we want them to be short and to the point so that we can get to as many of you as possible. So with that, I will step aside and ask you to join me in welcoming to the podium to formally introduce our panel for tonight. Baxter Stein is a second year in the college. He is a public policy major from Westport, Connecticut, very active in the IOP. He's currently an intern with us helping to program events like this. He's also involved in the Maroon Veterans Alliance. Please join me in welcoming Baxter.
Thanks, Steve. All right, so thank you to all of you for coming out tonight. In 5 days, the first caucus goers will head to the precincts in Iowa to start the first contest of the nomination process. During tonight's event, State of the Race, Primary Predictions, our speakers will analyze the race thus far and what to expect going forward into a season, as Steve alluded to, that has been anything but predictable. It is my pleasure to welcome Jennifer Jacobs, Stuart Stevens, David Axelrod, and Chip Griffin. Jennifer Jacobs is an award-winning journalist and currently the chief political reporter for the Des Moines Register. She has been at the forefront of all things Iowa, covering both sides of the high-stakes caucuses on the ground, tracking the candidates' every move. Also with us tonight is Stuart Stevens, one of the nation's most successful political strategists and media consultants. Stevens was lead strategist for the Romney presidential campaign and is currently an IOP fellow. You can find out more about his seminar series and sign up for his office hours at politics.uchicago.edu. On the panel as well is the IOP's own director, David Axelrod, who previously served as senior strategist to both Obama presidential campaigns. Lastly, we'll have a special appearance from communications strategist and editor of Primary Digest, Chip Griffin. He will be joining us from Washington via Skype. So there's a lot to unpack in this crazy election cycle. So without any further ado, please join me in welcoming our speakers tonight.
Thanks, Baxter. First of all, let me say, 4 years ago, I spent a lot of my time thinking about, maybe I should do this. I spent a lot of my time thinking about what Stuart was thinking about and trying to figure out how I could thwart that. So it's much more fun to be sitting on the same platform with him, trying to figure out what other people are thinking about. And we're really grateful to you, Stuart, not just for being here, but for being a fellow IOP
great thing here. Yeah.
This quarter. Chip, good to see you.
It is great to be here.
And appreciate you being with us from Washington. Have you been able to navigate the town? Have those weather wimps taken care of their problems there?
Well, you know, it's nothing compared to what we do in New Hampshire.
Yes. Yes. And Jennifer, so grateful to you, especially given the timing. It's a real treat to have you here. We won't tell that you slipped out of the state for a few hours to be with us. When was the first time, I want to ask both of you, that a 2016 presidential hopeful visited Iowa? When did you start covering these candidates?
It was Marco Rubio. Can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
It was Marco Rubio, and he came a couple days after the 2012 general election. I think it was 8 days after. And he came for a birthday party for the very popular Governor Branstad, Terry Branstad, and put his footprint in Iowa very, very early.
His bootprint?
Yes, his bootprint.
Yes. Chip, what about you? When did you start seeing candidates up there?
They never stopped visiting.
Yeah. They just, right after the election.
Right after the election, yeah. I mean, it's they always want to lay the groundwork, and sometimes they'll lay it even a cycle or two ahead of when they actually plan on doing something.
The I pulled up this morning as we were thinking about this some quaint clips from a year ago, 11 months ago. Scott Walker grabs lead in New Hampshire, a new poll. Can you explain who Scott Walker is?
Sure. He's the guy that everybody thought would have a huge advantage in Iowa because he was from our neighboring state of Wisconsin. He actually grew up in Iowa. He lived in Iowa until he was 9 years old, the son of a minister. And so everyone thought that he would have a real in with our religious conservative voters in Iowa who dominate our caucus process. And he just had the profile of somebody who was going to soar right to the top. And in fact, he did. As soon as he made his introductory speech in January of last year, he immediately went to the top of our polls and was at the top of our polls for the first half of 2015, and then Trump.
Stuart, yes. And I have another headline here. In early polling, Walker stands apart. Now he stands in Madison, Wisconsin. He's not even, he's running. And then here's another headline. Hillary Clinton, way ahead of opponents in Iowa. This was from...
That's an evergreen.
This is from like late October, early November of 2015. So just to point out the fickleness of this process. Now, if I want to put up a graphic, what happens to Chip? He goes away. Chip, bear with us. We're going to bring you right back. Let's take a look at the national polls right now, and it's probably, we're going to spend less time talking about those because in a way they're irrelevant. Can we put up so here's the national, this is an aggregate of national primary polls as of tonight, and you see Donald Trump there at 38%, Ted Cruz at 16, Marco Rubio at 10, and everybody underneath. Dr. Ben Carson, who had his turn on top of the pile there is in fourth. Jeb Bush, who was the early front runner, in fifth. Chris Christie, who was touted right after the last election as the guy to run and then ran into a problem, and all the others. Let's look at the Democratic national polling. And there you have it, Hillary Clinton 15 points ahead of Bernie Sanders. Stuart, are you surprised by that number that Bernie Sanders has made as strong a bid as he has?
I've spent a lot of, I kind of have to live in Vermont. And so I've watched Bernie Sanders. And I will say this, he's the most consistent human being on the planet. We were talking about. He's been saying the same thing for 40 years. I've made a little sport of going to these rallies over in New Hampshire, and I've been to a half dozen Bernie Sanders rallies, a half dozen.
Let's bring Chip back, by the way.
Hillary Clinton rally. And the thing about, you go to a Bernie Sanders rally, I'm sure you've had this experience, people know why they're there. You don't wander into a Bernie Sanders rally. They are there and largely for economic reasons, and I think that it's the economy that's driving this. They feel that there are these big, powerful forces in their lives that have this control over them, and they don't know what to do, and that a lot of them feel like they've done the right things and they haven't worked out. And I think Bernie Sanders really speaks to that in much the same way Donald Trump does, in a different way. But I think it's fascinating how the two sort of come together.
So let's talk to you guys, because you've probably seen more of these candidates than everyone else. What and let's start with Iowa, because it's the first event. We do have, and I don't want to lose Chip. We'll get back to this at some point. But you know, I just mentioned the polls. I mean, it is a stark poll where Sanders has just been on an upward scheme in Iowa. Where do you think the race is now?
Well, there's definitely a sense in Iowa that we're witnessing history, that we could be seeing, to use Bernie's word, a revolution on both sides, that it is about pocketbook issues, like Stuart said. It's about people feeling like they cannot keep ahead of their bills and feeling like, you know, it's the low wages and working millions of hours and not getting ahead. And it's the same thing on Trump's side. They feel like they're witnessing a revolution on that side, and it's a revolution for which no one has any idea what the consequences are. But people do feel a sense that, you know, this is coming. So you know, people see in Bernie Sanders the opposite of what they see in Hillary Clinton in some ways. Democratic voters in Iowa adore Hillary Clinton. She has very high favorability ratings, so don't get me wrong. They like both Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton, but they see in Bernie Sanders as somebody who is authentic. When he says, you know, Hillary Clinton just doesn't pass the laugh test when she says that she can take down Wall Street, when she took all these speaking fees from Goldman Sachs, or, you know, how can she say she has good judgment when she voted for the Iraq War in 2002, which was one of the most significant foreign policy decisions of her career and mine. And voters just nod at that and respond to just about everything Bernie says, but then they look at Hillary and they say, you know, they believe her argument. Her closing argument is the world is a very complex place. Being president is extraordinarily difficult, and I have the best resume to be president. And they believe her when she says that. They really do. So it's, I hear from every Democratic voter, they're really torn between the two. They could go for either, but some people are voting for the guy who they think has the better vision. Others are going for the woman who they also like very, very much, but think that she's just more presidential.
How did they react in the last few weeks when they started skirmishing? How did Democrats? I felt like there was a reluctance on the part of both campaigns to be on the attack because of what you said, because they're both well liked by Democrats in Iowa, but they've both taken some pretty hard shots.
Except it's been polite. You know, just yesterday in Iowa, one of the reporters asked Bernie Sanders.
Polite by Donald Trump standards, or really polite?
Polite by Trump standards. You know, do you think that Hillary Clinton is someone who can't be trusted? And he said, listen, she's a very distinguished woman. I've known her for years, and I respect her. You know, so they have good things to say about each other. It's been a more polite conversation than you might think.
I actually, Stuart, I've been watching that with interest. It seems Bernie has pulled up short in a number of these debates where he really could have gone much more aggressively at Hillary Clinton.
He's very inexperienced. You know, I mean, for all his running for office, he's really had one tough race. And where he ran that three-way against the Democrat and Republican, and it is true that he wouldn't have won that race if he hadn't made that deal on guns. And as a national figure, compared to Hillary Clinton, I mean, his experience is minimal.
So you think that it was just inexperience, it wasn't a strategy or a expression of his personality that he didn't go after her in the way that a savage consultant like yourself would have advised him?
I think that you always have to be careful when you attack someone that has really high favorables. It's, you know, you know very well. But I think that there is on the emails, there is a logical connection on the trust argument, that you don't have to say, you know, you're a crook, that you've done something illegal, but it goes to a tying the same person who takes this money and, you know, makes $300,000 a speech and sets up her own email system, and it's sort of like the rules don't apply to me. I'm special. And I think that there was an argument to be crafted there that he walked away from. Now, there's a bunch of really smart people in that campaign. They're doing extraordinarily well. To the degree it was spontaneous or calculated, you know, or calculated makes it sound part of a larger strategy, I have no idea. But to me, it made him look weaker than stronger. Hmm.
Chip, where are you going here, guys? I need Chip. Chip, in New Hampshire, Bernie is a more familiar figure than he was in Iowa. How much of his advantage there, and he started off well behind there as well, is a function of familiarity with him as a senator from the neighboring state, and how much of it is something more organic to this race?
Yeah, so I don't think very much of Sanders has to do with the neighboring state factor. You know, that happens more with politicians from Massachusetts because we watch a lot of Boston television, read a lot of Boston newspapers. But frankly, not a lot of people in New Hampshire are following Vermont media. So I don't think that's really what it is. I think it's that he's speaking to the desire of a lot of members of the Democratic Party who, you know, really want to engage in a bit more of a fight for the issues they care about. It's really the same dynamic that's driving Trump. You know, people want to be passionate about the issues, and they want their candidates to be passionate about the issues.
And how do you, when you go to events in New Hampshire, how do you see the crowds, relative crowds, with between Clinton and Sanders, and the way they interact with people?
So the Sanders crowds are more, you know, uniformly enthusiastic, I would say. The Clinton crowds, though, really have the female voters, and I see so many mothers bringing their daughters and saying, you know, take a look up on the stage there, see what you can be. So that's a huge element of her support in New Hampshire, and as I suspect it is elsewhere as well. But it's, you know, it's the kind of thing where, you know, moms are taking their daughters out of school to go to these events. So it's two different dynamics, but they both have enthusiasm in their own way.
Do you, Jennifer talked about this this conflict that people have in Iowa in their heads about the virtues of Hillary Clinton as someone who has experience, who's prepared, seems to be central to her message that I know how to navigate the real world. And implicit in that is that Bernie is a well-intentioned kind of gadfly. The Sanders argument is, as Jennifer outlined, one about political revolution and really challenging in a way that Hillary's message is not. Is that how it's playing out there? Is that how voters are perceiving the choice?
To be honest, David, I'm sorry. I only picked up about half of your question there.
Well, answer that half. the question is, how do voters perceive the two of them? What is the choice here? One of the things, the reason I raise that question is because sometimes, I think in the last week or two, the Clinton message has become clearer, but Bernie Sanders' message is crystal clear, which is, you know, it's about the billionaires and it's about the banks and it's about economic fairness and so on. Her message, because she is the master of policy, has been more diffuse. Do you think that her message has become clearer, and is the choice clear to voters in New Hampshire now between sort of the experienced navigator, the tenacious navigator of the system, versus the guy who's going to really challenge the system in a different way?
Oh, yeah, I think that's absolutely crystal clear to the voters. You know, it's one of those things where if what you're looking for is for, you know, someone who has that experience and the steady hand, you're more likely to be with Clinton. But the Sanders folks, you know, they're the idealists. They're the dreamers. And one of the interesting statistics for New Hampshire is that one out of three voters in this year's primary probably weren't eligible to vote in 2008, so just 8 years ago. And a lot of the folks who are coming into New Hampshire are people who are going there for a different way of life, a change. And so Sanders is really speaking to that element of the population.
So the people, when you say they weren't eligible to vote, they aren't necessarily young. They're people who are moving to the state.
Yeah, it's a mix of both of them. You know, I think, and I forget the exact statistic, but I think it's almost half of them were too young, and then the other half have migrated in from elsewhere.
I think this is where Clinton's inevitability argument works against her. Because if you just put yourself in the mindset of a Sanders voter, on the one hand, the Clinton people are saying she's going to win anyway, that we can survive this, that it's sort of out there. So that, to me, gives you a pass to vote for Sanders. If you can vote, it's sort of like that, you know, in Europe, in the first election and the second election, you know, vote your heart in the first and your wallet in the second. Why not vote for Sanders if you're a Democrat? Send a message. You don't have to worry about the consequences of it because if Hillary Clinton's going to win anyway, what's it matter?
And you hear that a lot. You hear that about among a lot of Democrats. I had an email from a friend of mine who I grew up with who lives in Pittsburgh, and he said, I think I'm going to vote for I'll vote for Hillary in the end, but I think I'll vote for Bernie first just to annoy her. And so I think there's...
It's a bigger story.
There's something to that. Not a sense that if she were to lose these races that she'll lose the nomination. There's an overwhelming presumption that she'll win. So you can... You can make a statement by voting for him. So let's talk a little bit about organization in these states, because particularly in Iowa, much is made of organization. Caucuses are not primaries. Caucuses involve a big devotion of time, and it involves standing up in front of your neighbors and declaring yourself in a very public way. So, you know, I've often said that I don't think Barack Obama, as much as popular as he was, had he not started organizing in March of 2007, I'm not sure he would have won the Iowa caucuses. You know, he didn't win by that much. How would you assess the relative state of organizations and enthusiasm right now?
So Bernie just kind of magically draws in these gigantic crowds. And Clinton's people would say, well, we don't know if those are out-of-staters. He tends to go to border communities. He was just in Decorah, and he drew a lot of people.
He did say that about Obama, too, in 2007.
Minnesota and Wisconsin. He's in Council Bluffs. He draws a lot of people from Nebraska. Clinton's people say, when we have our events, we know who these people are. We recognize them. They're Iowans. They're coming. And one interesting thing, so Hillary Clinton has one way of organizing, of getting people in the door and collecting their name and, you know, their email address, is just to get them in the door to begin with. And so she has, you know, Katy Perry coming and singing for her, and Demi Lovato, and she's got Bill Clinton coming and Chelsea, and she gets people in the door that way. But then she has this other strategy that she does where she waits.
Locks the door?
She waits out into the audience, and she has this interesting touch, and you hear a lot of our Democratic voters talking about this quite a bit, where Sanders doesn't. He does the big rally speeches like Trump does and just kind of stands at the podium and does his big bellowing speeches and gets everyone all fired up and then he leaves. Whereas Hillary Clinton, this time, seems very welcoming and accessible to our Democratic voters. I'm hearing that from everyone. In fact, I just got an email 2 days ago from a woman named Janelle, and she said she had gone to one of the Hillary Clinton events. It would happen to be the Katy Perry rock concert. And she was holding up a sign that said, I just completed my 13th round of chemo, just 3 more to go, hear me roar. Mm. And Bill Clinton saw her sign from up on stage, came down and approached her, and she was in tears, and he was hugging and taking photos with her daughter, and then leaves. And then a police officer approaches her and says, Hillary Clinton would like to meet you. Can you please come behind stage? And so she does, and cue the tears again, and she says Hillary just listened to her and talked to her and comforted her. And then she decided to go to the Democratic debate, and one of Hillary Clinton's aides recognized her in the audience and said, oh my gosh, how's radiation going? Hillary will want to talk to you. Please come over here. And sure enough, Hillary recognized her and remembered her name. And then a third time, again, so she's recognized, she goes to a meeting at the historical building of the Hillary Clinton rally, and Hillary sees Janelle and just remembers everything about her and just, you know, very personal. And we're hearing, you know, another woman emailed and said,
she gonna caucus for Hillary?
Oh, I think so. I mean, it's so good. And you know, you go around and tell all your friends these stories. So it's like, you know, this person by person connection that is being made.
Is this different than what you saw in 2008?
She did wade into the crowd in 2008, but it seemed like people didn't feel like they were making that personal connection. And I hear, the Janelle story is kind of extreme, but I hear that from so many people. They feel like Hillary Clinton is their friend. They feel like she recognizes them, she knows them, she's gone. One woman said she had a house party and Hillary Clinton came and they thought she would stay for half an hour. She stayed for 4 hours talking at the kitchen table with his family.
Sounds like a Saturday Night Live skit, actually. The fact that Bernie Sanders gives his speech and goes, I mean, he was here. I don't know if any of you were here when he was here, but it was quite a scene and quite a crowd, and but on the way in, we taped a podcast with him. And at the end, I said, well, you know, you're kind of an unlikely rock star, you know. And he said, don't get me going on those selfies. He says, I don't want to talk about those selfies. Everybody wants a selfie. And it was clear that, you know, that aspect of campaigning was not his thing. She seems to be...
She is embracing it this time. And she has also said, I can't stand selfies. Everyone wants to do it. And she said, the reason she doesn't like them is because she doesn't get a chance to talk to voters. You just have to freeze and, you know, snap a photo, and then she doesn't get to actually have a conversation.
But in terms of the level of organization, which is important in the caucuses, who has the better organization in Iowa?
Equal, as far as I can tell. Bernie Sanders has tons of people coming in from out of state who are, you know, organizing means making phone calls. It's the one-on-one contact. People, volunteers who come into the offices and make phone calls to their fellow Iowans, or go knock on doors, or, you know, go distribute flyers and things like that. It is really hard for me to tell who has a better organization. I'm going to say they're about equal. The trick for Bernie Sanders is that he has a lot of young people who support him, and so his support is concentrated in our three college towns. And so the way the Iowa caucuses work, as you probably know, it's not just a head count. It's not very democratic. It's actually, you go and stand in a corner, and then you get a certain number of delegates based on, you know, the number of people in your room. And Bernie has an excess of support in these college towns, and there's just a limited number of delegates that he can win, whereas in some of the smaller areas, he doesn't have as much support, and those are really delegate-rich areas. So even though maybe Bernie Sanders has, you know, 50,000 supporters, he might not get as many delegates as Hillary Clinton because her support is spread more around the state. So it's...
Now, they're trying to remedy that by busing their kids back to the... or shuttling their kids back to their hometowns to vote. How effective, has that ever been done effectively before?
That's really tricky, and you've got college students who have to go to class the next day. Our caucuses are on a Monday night. Last cycle, they fell during our Christmas holidays, and so students were home with their families anyway, they're in their hometowns anyway. This time they're away at school. And so Bernie Sanders is renting vans and buses and getting cars and trying to get these college students to go back to their hometowns to balance out his vote so that he captures all those delegates. It is really, really hard to get students to decide to go to the next bar down the street, much less all the way back to their hometown on a maybe cold and snowy night when they've got classes the next day and other things going on. But we'll see.
Kegs in the van, is that or free Ben and Jerry's ice cream. Chip, what about in New Hampshire? What's how would you assess on the Democratic side, because we're going to get to the Republican side in a second, the level of organization of these candidates, and how important is that in what is a primary where you don't have to do the things, run through the hoops you have to in a caucus?
Yeah, we have a process that people can actually understand here.
This is why we have Chip coming in on video, because we didn't want to put them together.
Yes.
We thought there'd be some regional tension here.
Although I will give credit to Iowa, because this time I think Iowa could have a major impact on how New Hampshire votes, but we can get to that at some other point. Organizationally, the two campaigns are both strong in New Hampshire, but very different. The Clinton campaign is really more of a professional, top-down organizational structure, lots of actual offices, paid staff, that sort of thing. And the Sanders campaign is more traditional, democratic, grassroots, organizing, sort of the labor union types that just get together and seem to be loosely coordinated with the campaign, but it's not clear to me exactly how well, you know, the mothership is really aware of and controlling it.
And should I extrapolate from that that you think the Clinton campaign has a more effective organization?
I would say that they have a more traditionally effective organization, but this isn't a traditional year. And so maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe all of the lessons that we've learned in the past about how to organize a campaign, how to run a campaign is totally different. I mean, if you had suggested to me, 6 months ago, a year ago, that Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump would refuse the opportunity to debate right before the caucus and primaries, you'd be thought you were out of your mind. So it's very different than anything we've ever seen before.
Yeah.
Right. So if Hillary Clinton and Ted Cruz win Iowa, the conventional wisdom about organization holds, because Ted Cruz has been doing the grind also. But if Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump wins, it throws that whole model out the window. It really raises questions about the Iowa model.
Chip, you said that you thought the caucuses would impact on the New Hampshire primary. Is that true on both sides? Would you say it'll have an impact on the Democratic side? I'm just trying to keep this an orderly Democratic conversation and moving on to the Republican thing.
Sure. Yeah, I think it has an impact on both sides. On the Democratic side, I think it's hard to see Bernie not winning in New Hampshire at this point. I mean, it's not going to be a 2-1 victory like some of the polls suggest, but it would take some dramatic development over the next 12, 13 days for him not to win. However, I think that the Iowa result will affect the margin in New Hampshire on the Democratic side.
So if Bernie does better in Iowa, it will enlarge his margin. I've heard that from a number of people inside his camp. They believe that, and they believe if she wins in Iowa, it'll narrow the race in New Hampshire, which isn't always the way it is. Sometimes New Hampshire plays a contrarian role,
right?
As I learned painfully in 2008. We went in 5 days out, 11 points up in New Hampshire, and we left with a hearty handshake in the home game, and Hillary Clinton won the primary. Let's move on to the Republican picture, and again, let's start with New Hampshire. I'm sorry, with Iowa. Here we go. Chip, we just pushed you out of the way for a while.
The audience will appreciate that.
We're going to bring you back by popular demand in a second. So here you have Donald Trump and Ted Cruz in a virtual tie. This is a poll of polls. Now, I should point out that the much heralded Des Moines Register poll comes out this weekend, right? The final Des Moines Register poll, and it's been quite accurate historically.
Our pollster, Ann Seltzer, has predicted the caucus winner every cycle that she's been doing this, and that's since 1988.
Yeah, so a little plug for the Des Moines Register right there. But here you see essentially a two-person race between Trump and Cruz. Let's get Chip back here. The dynamics of this race have been a little crazy, as everything involved in the Republican race has since Donald Trump entered in June. A few weeks ago, when I spoke to Republicans, they felt, and Stuart, you should chime in on this because you talk to these guys all the time, pretty confident that Cruz was going to win the Iowa caucuses, that he had so thoroughly organized the evangelicals, the social conservatives, he had enough Tea Party support, and he was so rigorously organized that he would win. Has the chatter on the ground changed in the last few, along with the polling in the last few days?
Well, Ted Cruz, I do think it's a very tight race, and you can tell me if you disagree, but I do think it's very, very close. There's some polls out there that show it's not close, and I think I'm skeptical of those polls. But with Ted Cruz, he has more challenges than any front runner I can think of. He's got two past Iowa caucus winners to compete against, Mike Huckabee and Rick Santorum.
Both of whom have big appeal to social conservatives.
Yes, exactly. Then he's got Ben Carson to deal with, who also is taking a chunk of the evangelical vote. He's in double digits in Iowa. He's got the ethanol lobby, our renewable fuels lobby, absolutely just hammering him because they don't like his stance on renewable fuels.
And the governor's jumped on
the
that.
The governor of our state came out and said, do not vote for Ted Cruz. I mean, he broke his pledge to stay neutral because he was so alarmed at what message it would send if Iowa gives the victory to somebody who's so opposed to renewable fuels, which is, you know, it's our ag economy is very much tied to renewable fuels, and so our governor truly feels like it would be damaging to our state. And then he's got the Trump phenomenon. So, I mean, Ted Cruz just has it just incoming from all directions. So if he still wins the Iowa caucus, I think that sends a pretty strong message that he overcame a lot and still won. But
Stuart,
I refuse to feel sorry for Ted Cruz. I'm sorry.
Well, you've
not even Jennifer can make me feel sorry for Ted Cruz.
But you've been even harsher in your critique of Donald Trump. I saw a poll in the last couple of days that showed Trump only six points behind Cruz among evangelical voters. How does Donald Trump, as you and I have talked about, how does a guy who's a casino operator, married three times, used to be, ardently pro-choice, and there are a whole range of other things here.
Well,
how is he competing with Ted Cruz for the evangelical?
Hell if I know. I think the greatest mystery to me in this race is how is it that it's close to the caucuses, close to New Hampshire, and no Republican campaign has managed to get it together to have a sustained effort against Donald Trump. And I think
that's not true. Rick Perry went after him.
A sustained.
Scott Walker took some shots at him.
Sustained effort.
I'm trying to make a point.
And I think one of the things that I just keep hearing, which I think is absolutely the wrong way to look at politics, is this obsession this cycle with lanes. I feel like we're in this giant highway project. Everybody says, well, he's in this lane, he's in that lane. I don't think that the Iowa Republican electorate is that diverse. We're not talking about New York City where they're teaching 27 languages in schools and you have this. They all vote the same way, 99% come November. They all vote for Branstad. This is not a wildly diverse group of people. And I think that when candidates and campaigns have gotten into this, well, we're only going to go after voters in our lane, I think they're walking away from a lot of potential voters. What was Donald Trump's lane 6 months ago when he was, at 8%? He went out and made a lane, and I think that's how
you
go out and win.
I think he took over the highway.
Yeah, he took over. And I think there has been this assumption that Donald Trump was unelectable and unnominatable. So therefore, there has been this competition, and this is most noticeable with this Jeb Bush pack, to be the last person standing against Donald Trump because then you had to win. And I think that's way overthinking it. I think you got one person who's ahead, he's got a bunch of votes. Go get him. And it's about showing that you're a strong candidate.
You know, I hear you, but when you think about who's won the Iowa caucuses, Rick Santorum, Huckabee,
well, Romney
Pat
won
Robinson,
it when it counted.
Robinson, huh?
We won it when it counted for 2 weeks.
Yeah, you had it for 2 weeks, yeah. It's true. You rented it. But the point is, there is a strong social conservative base that
they're
makes
all conservative.
But is a religiously oriented base that is different than say New Hampshire. So it is kind of a but specifically that Trump is competing, he is getting votes across the spectrum. The fact that he's getting votes from there though, and really pushing Cruz among those. Which is why Ted Cruz is running an abortion ad against Donald Trump in
voters,
Iowa.
Look, you've done this a million times. You know, you sit in a focus group, you test this stuff. I see these Franklin's focus groups. They go, oh, I don't believe it. It doesn't work. That's just not how politics is. It's the way Hemingway said about going bankrupt. It happens slow, gradually, then all at once. And I think that the repeated delivery of information about Donald Trump has been lacking in this race. And I think that most voters really don't know very much about Donald Trump. And I think that when they do, he will not. He is a very unlikely Republican nominee.
It is true that there have been not a steady stream of attacks on him. But he, He's also repelled those attacks that he's had. He seems to be impervious to some degree. The audacity of him seems to carry him through.
But that's because they've been fighting on his turf. You know, one of the phenomena about Donald Trump is he's not spending much money. So it's sort of like, you know, Saddam. Remember when he challenged George Bush and said, you know, only men fight with on the ground. You know, we don't need planes. It's as if George Bush said, oh, you're right. We'll forget the planes. We'll just fight it out on the ground. You know, no. You challenge Donald Trump. Make him spend money. Will he spend money? He said he's going to spend $2 million a week. He didn't.
One, you cringed at Cruz, and then you tantrumed about Trump. So trying to be alliterative here. But but one interesting thing to me over this weekend, Jennifer, was to see your senator, Chuck Grassley, one of the deans of the Republican Caucus of the United States Senate, at a Trump rally. And apparently, so Cruz is so detested by his Senate colleagues that that Grassley decided he wanted to make America great again.
That caught us all off guard to suddenly see Chuck Grassley, our amazingly popular U.S. senator, up on stage introducing Donald Trump. We just did not see that coming. And so we've got our GOP triad of the most influential Republicans all, and Branstad saying very strongly, don't vote for Cruz, and then Grassley saying very subtly by introducing Donald Trump, he very specifically said, I am not endorsing. And he can still say that with a straight face because he didn't endorse, but he stood there in front of the world, in front of all the TV cameras, and very enthusiastically endorsed him. And then our third member is U.S. Senator Joni Ernst, who is also very popular in Iowa, and she gave that wink, wink, nod, nod for Marco Rubio. So you've got our three most powerful Republicans all like saying, come on, Iowans, don't vote for Ted Cruz. I mean, really strong message, but we'll see if endorsements work. Our Iowa Republicans especially tend not to be bandwagon voters. At least they'll tell you that. They'll say, we make our own decisions. We're not going to do what, you know, the elected officials tell us to do. We're going to make up our own minds.
You're not going to call between Cruz and Trump, I'm sorry. So I'm not going to ask you to do that. But I will ask you about third place, because that seems important here. Because despite Stewart's frustration with lanes, there is this issue of who might emerge other than Trump and Cruz, mm-hmm. who you won't wince over. And Rubio seems to be the guy who everybody points to. Is he going to finish third in Iowa?
Likely. And the interesting thing with Rubio is, so the caucuses are about expectations.
Chip, I'm setting up a segue to you, so.
I'll make it short, Chip. The caucuses are about expectations. It's all about the media set expectations for the candidates, and whoever overcomes those and does better than their expectations gets this, you know, huge round of congratulatory news coverage. It's almost guaranteed that Marco Rubio is going to get this very flattering news coverage, even if he finishes 20 points behind the front runners, just because the media has decided that, and some strategists as well, have decided that he is the last mainstream candidate standing. But what Iowa Republicans are saying is, listen, he presented himself to us as both establishment and anti-establishment, and we believe he's a conservative. They really looked him over, and he's very popular across the board with very conservative voters, with evangelical voters, with Tea Party voters, with moderate voters, with you know, even liberal voters. He's very popular across the board, and yet he cannot get out of double digits. And so it'll just be interesting for me to see how people portray if he only comes in a distant third.
Well, one of my questions is that what Jennifer says about Rubio is true, and Chip, you have seen it too. He seems intent on trying to appeal to every faction of the party. He's signified to the social conservatives, took a very strong stance on abortion at the first debates, more conservative than any Republican nominee has ever taken. He identifies as a Tea Party guy, and he is vying to be the candidate of the center-right establishment. Do you get into trouble at some point trying to be appeal to everyone? Do you lose your chance to dominate any of these, or does it all
I think this is all about winning states. I personally think that these first four contests are functional playoffs, Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, Nevada. and that you're going to have to win one of these states in all likelihood to get permission from voters to advance forward. If you're in Florida and you're in second or third place and you lose the first four, why should you advance? It just doesn't make sense to me. So,
well, that would suggest that Rubio could be eliminated under the...
I think you have to win.
Stevens rule.
I don't understand why you compete in states to do okay. I think you shouldn't compete in a state personally if you don't intend to win that state. You know, I was one of the geniuses working for George Bush in 2000 who thought that John McCain would be really hurt by his performance in Iowa. You know, we took a 65-point lead into New Hampshire and lost by 19. That's, you know, you got to really work at that. And so we couldn't have been more wrong. So I think the danger for Rubio, and you can remember this, is the Mo-Udall. You know, they keep doing well against Jimmy Carter. You keep doing well, but you don't win. You got to win. To win, you have to win. So that's my question, and I find Rubio a very attractive candidate, and I think he could be the next president of the United States. But he's got to get about the business of winning primaries.
Speaking of Mo Udall, Chip, there's that famous story of him walking into a barber shop when he was running for president in New Hampshire, saying, "I'm Mo Udall, and I'm running for president," and the barber said, "Yeah, we were just laughing about that." But, it's going to come to you guys, and as Stuart suggests, I think everyone is looking at New Hampshire as the place where the establishment Republican will emerge, that of the group of Rubio, John Kasich, Chris Christie, and Jeb Bush, the winner of that group, even despite the Stevens rule, if they finish second there to Trump, everyone seems to believe Trump's going to win the New Hampshire primary. But the second place finisher will then get to move forward into the process, and the others will fall away. First of all, do you buy that theory?
Well, so, I mean, you have to keep in mind, New Hampshire is not an establishment state on the Republican side. You know, Pat Buchanan got 40% against 41, and he actually won in 96, which a lot of people forget. Ron Paul got in the mid-20s. In New Hampshire. I mean, we have a habit on the Republican side of going for non-establishment candidates. So I think it would be risky to assume that New Hampshire will play that role. That said, there's a large enough portion of the voter base on the Republican side in New Hampshire to give a serious boost to someone who is, you know, perhaps, I don't know what you want to call it, more establishment, more mainstream than Trump or Cruz.
And of those candidates that I mentioned, who is going into this final weekend with, well, it's not the final weekend for you, but who's going in 10 days out? Who has the momentum among that group, and will the Iowa caucuses impact on that?
Yeah, so I mean, I would say just, you know, sort of on the ground, watching what average voters are doing, John Kasich's the one who has some momentum at this point. Now, that may do him a whole hill of no good because he doesn't really have much going on anywhere else. You know, I think if Rubio were to exceed expectations in Iowa, in other words, not just finish third, but, you know, a convincing third, I think that would be something that would impact his vote total in New Hampshire. But I think the most interesting thing to watch in Iowa is the Trump-Cruz battle, because I think, you know, we've all wondered, what is it that's going to cause Trump a problem? And I think if he loses to Cruz in Iowa, I think that spells real danger for him, because his whole campaign strategy, I mean, he's a pugilist, not a policy wonk, and if he can't win in Iowa, how is he going to get Mexico to pay for a wall?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, I think we all
I
know.
I like that. Write that down.
Do you make that up? Or did you hear another candidate say that?
Good.
That is true. I think the other element is how he personally will process a loss. I mean, this is a guy who starts every presentation off with a recitation of his poll numbers. He loves them, as I said the other day in a piece I wrote, he caresses them. And if he is now not number one, how will he take that? I don't think anybody knows the answer to that, but
it won't be his fault, that we know.
Yes, it'll be Fox News. By the way, does skipping the debate have any impact in either of your states on voters? You suggested before we came out here that you thought voters in Iowa are not going to like that.
I'm just getting mixed messages. I follow a lot of activists in Iowa on Twitter, and I read their Facebook messages and things like that. And today, especially, people were saying, okay, this is a turning point for me. This is childish. This is just a little too erratic for me. It may be even unstable. A few people said he committed to doing this debate, and now he's backing out. If we can't trust him to keep commitments, I mean, what on earth? And, you know, other people say, you know, he stepped all over his immigration message that, you know, the day he said he probably wouldn't come to the debate. He was supposed to be doing this big event in Marshalltown, which is one of our towns that has a big problem with illegal immigration, and with this sheriff, Joe Arpaio. It was supposed to be this big immigration day, and he stepped on that news to go off in this other direction, and people are just saying, you know, he's just making our heads spin. And it just, a few people emailed and said, you know, if he's that erratic, do I trust him to be the commander-in-chief and in charge of our kids going away to war? Hmm.
Now, that was a citizen who did that. Was that Ted Cruz who emailed?
Regular voter.
Chip, do you think that this has any impact on people's assessment of him? Fox News has a pretty strong foothold in the Republican electorate.
Yeah, they absolutely do. You know, look, I think that it has to be combined with a loss in Iowa. I think if he wins Iowa, it becomes irrelevant. So I don't think it has a direct impact on New Hampshire. But if it was paired with that loss, that I think could be the 1-2 punch that takes him out.
Stuart, your suggestion is that I am of the mind that if Trump wins Iowa now, after Cruz had been heralded for so long as the guy who was going to win Iowa, if Trump wins Iowa and he goes on and wins a good victory in New Hampshire, I think he's going to be hard to stop. I think it's going to be hard to stop.
Well, look, you know, my success in the Trump prediction business is worse than his bankruptcies. I think every time that we say this time it's different, be it politics or finance or sports, it turns out not to be different. You know, it's 99 and the NASDAQ doesn't go to 10,000. It's 2007 and house prices don't keep going up. I think that, just as in The Big Short, it's easier to estimate what will happen than when it'll happen. And Donald Trump as a nominee of the Republican Party would be an utter disaster. You would lose the Senate, it would split the party. It would be a very self-destructive.
Yeah, that's a different question, though, than whether he'll be the nominee of the Republican Party.
I think parties, I just think that people ultimately tend to do what's in their best interest. And I think that he is so different than anyone else who's winning these elections that it would be very inconsistent.
Let me just read you some numbers from the Wall Street Journal NBC poll that just came out. Among Republicans, would you find, as the Republican candidate for president, acceptable or unacceptable? Donald Trump, 65% said they would accept him. Cruz, 66. Rubio, 67. Ben Carson, 62. Now, Jeb Bush was at 52, and who started off as the front runner in this race. The Trump number is noteworthy, but so is the Bush number. Let's just take 1 minute on what the heck happened to Jeb Bush. Chip, you want to chime in on that?
Yes, I mean, you know, Jeb just has never really been able to generate a group of supporters that are actually excited about him. And it's hard to be...
Even with the exclamation point?
Even with the exclamation point. I mean, the only thing I can say in Jeb's favor at this point is that he has cultivated a group of curious voters in the last couple of weeks in New Hampshire, people who are talking about him and wondering about him, but that's a far cry from supporting him. And you know, if you don't have any passion for your candidacy from your supporters, or, I mean... Frankly, I mean, the Trump low energy thing seems on the mark. He doesn't seem all that visibly passionate in himself. It's hard to imagine that person becoming president.
The Bush campaign and the Bush super PAC have spent more money in Iowa than any other campaign. Has it had any perceptible impact there?
I think Rubio's close, isn't he? Rubio and his super PACs have been almost matched. I think Bright to Rise and Jeb together are at 58, and Rubio's people are combined just below that. But no, it hasn't had much of an impact for either of them, either Jeb Bush or Marco Rubio. It's just, I don't think it's an establishment year. And I think even though Marco Rubio portrays himself as somebody who can apply to, or, you know, can appeal to everybody, it's just, it's just not catching fire there.
It's an interesting thing because, as Stuart pointed out, Donald Trump, until the last few weeks, has spent virtually nothing. In fact, I'm of the opinion that he was making money on the campaign by leasing his plane to himself. And yet he's dominated the race since he got in June. And, I mean, this is bad for business, too. I'm retired. But you're still in the business, man. How are you going to explain this?
Just on the Jeb thing. I think the...
And why don't you guys start queuing up for questions? Yeah,
and I like Jeb Bush a lot. I'd be very comfortable with Jeb Bush as president. I think that the biggest mistake personally that they've made is talking about what he did as Florida. Because I know just from experience in Romney world, whenever we looked at this, talking about what he did in Massachusetts, there was very limited appeal and that to hear about it versus what you would do as president. So to me, it's trying to sell like an iPhone 7 by showing someone a flip phone. You know, you say, well, like the world's best flip phone, but what does it have to do with your ability to produce a great phone? And I think that that has kept him one foot in the past instead of the future. A strategic mistake.
Yeah, I think on Bush, I think that, as I've written about and I've said, I think that there is an instinct on the part of Republican voters to pick the candidate who has the qualities that they see lacking in President Obama. Mm-hmm. That it's the opposite. And Jeb Bush, frankly, he has some of the same idiosyncrasies. In terms of, you know, he got asked, other candidates said they were going to rip up the Iran treaty. Bush said, well, first I'm going to appoint my cabinet, then I'm going to talk to my allies, and so on. And which is the question, that's sort of the answer you want a president to give, but not necessarily the one Republican Party primary voters want to hear from their nominee. Two more numbers I want to read, and then I'll take the question. On this NBC poll, the best chance to win, Trump 56, Cruz 17. And as you know, these things do tend to build on themselves. So that's a significant number. But who would bring change? Trump 51, Cruz was second at 17. This is nationwide. The only place where Cruz beat Trump was on best personality, actually. So kind of unusual, but anyway, questions.
So my question will be about electability. So first, on the Republican side, do anyone care about electability? Because Cruz and Trump seem like the most unelectable Republicans out there at the field right now. And on the Democrat side, is the Sanders surge a bit fueled by Democrats looking at Republican race with glee, saying that we will beat this guy even if we pull someone out of the street and make them a Democrat? So who cares about electability and to what extent?
Well, you know, Jack Germond, who is a journalist of a certain wonderful journalist, used to say that those candidates that depend on electability seldom are, which I always thought was a great way to put it. I think that you tend to think whoever you're for can win or you wouldn't be for them for the most part. It's a home team advantage. I mean, what team do you think, okay, I'm for... this team, particularly at the beginning of the season, you know, everybody thinks the Cubs are going to go to the Super, are going to go to the all the way to the.
I think they are
the World
actually.
Series. So, I think that you have this phenomenon that the two candidates are leading the Republican Party, both of whom I think would lose the Senate with them, and I think if the party nominates either one. Will lose.
The fact is that's happened before in history. I mean, you nominate Barry Goldwater. We nominate George McGovern.
Look, if the party has to go through that, the party has to go through that. I tend to think it won't do that, if for no other reason than the first instinct of politics is to hold on to what you have. The second is to get more. And this, you have the Senate now, and you have all these Senate races, and you know, there's only one senator in 2012 who was a Republican who was elected in a tight race where in a state that Mitt Romney lost, and that was in Nevada with Heller, and he won by 0.03% in a three-way. So if you don't have a Republican candidate who's winning Ohio, who's at least doing well in Pennsylvania, who's winning Florida, you're going to lose the Senate. They just can't get there with the math.
I can tell you what Republican Iowa Republicans who support Trump say, and that is they do believe that Trump is very, very electable, and he has proven that when he went after Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton on the whole, you know, the sexual trysts thing. They feel like he really shut her down on that and showed that he can just be a steamroller who crushes everything in his past. In his path. So I do think that Republicans who back Trump think that he can crush anyone.
And in terms of the Democratic Party, I think Stuart raised a really good point earlier, which is I think that people think they can have their cake and eat it too, that Bernie Sanders isn't going to be the nominee of the party. They can vote for him, and ultimately Hillary will prevail, and that she may be the most, you know, fortified for a general.
And we should know, this is an amazing moment. You know, I find the Sanders thing in many ways more fascinating than the Trump thing, because I think it's more meaningful, ultimately, I think. We'll see. But Sanders beats everybody. He does better against all the Republicans than Hillary Clinton. And if we just said that an obscure socialist from a tiny state was going to do that.
Or even a well-known socialist.
That's a pretty amazing moment.
Yeah, well, let me just say, I like Bernie Sanders, and I think he's run a spectacular campaign. Right. But no one's really touched him. I mean, and no one's touched him for a reason. If the Republican Party thought Bernie Sanders was a bigger threat, they wouldn't be running ads in Iowa that seemed calculated to try and get liberal voters to go to vote for Bernie Sanders, which is what's happening right now. You mentioned the Cubs. The Ricketts family has a super PAC. They're running ads in Iowa that flay Bernie for being for government-run health care and taxes on the rich and going after Wall Street. Well, I don't think that's going to hurt them in the caucuses, and I don't think they think so either. Yes, next question.
Thank you. I have a question about the role media could play in straightening out the facts. And I did a little bit of research on the illegal immigration in the United States, and I found that what Trump has said in his speech is very ill-timed and also unfounded, because you know, the Mexican immigrants peaked in 2007, and there was a dramatic demographic shift in Mexico, and there were far fewer Mexicans, you know, trying to cross the border. And also we see that in the Obama's administration, they spent tons of money on the deportation and the enforcement.
Right.
So that's, I mean, it's Donald Trump had his way of building walls, but we know that the border, you know, has 2,000 miles. And
yes.
It's not just the border between the Mexico
just
and
just in the
United
interest
States.
Of time, let's just...
Yeah, so my question is how could the American media straighten out facts?
I think the American media is consistently challenging Donald Trump on the facts. I don't think his supporters particularly care. I think that, you know, they view that as so much elite kind of propaganda, and they don't care. So, I mean, that's one of the phenomena of that. That's part of the phenomena of Donald Trump, is he's not constrained by the facts and sometimes even good taste. But his audience appreciates the audacity of him, and they don't really care about that. So I think that I don't think the media is guilty of not. I mean, I do commentary on CNN. They always have fact checks. They always put the big false next to his claims, and it's like a big ho-hum to his supporters. So, I think, you know, people should keep on fact checking, and those who care about facts will respond to him. And there's no doubt that if he moves on, that perhaps people will start challenging him more vigorously. His opponents, but I don't think it's going to affect his voters.
I think it's a larger question. I think this happens a lot, and you can look at the gun discussion. You know, gun violence has gone down 50% in the last 20 years. That's a fact. And you know, I think that people are very resistant, and there's a lot of studies on this, to data changing their opinions. And Donald Trump, in this case, is dealing with a very emotional issue. And I think that emotion, as is the case actually with guns, trumps the logic.
Stuart, after this, we'll go take a ride about a mile from here. I want you to tell everybody that gun violence is down 50%. Let's take the next question, please.
Very briefly, do you see in Sanders a repeat of the last time a Vermonter ran in Iowa? He had energy, he had enthusiasm, and he came in third.
But he was a Democrat.
Yes, Howard Dean. And second, very briefly, in the old days, Iowa and New Hampshire were key because if you didn't do well, you couldn't raise money. All those rules are out the window.
Right.
There's money everywhere. Are they less important than they used to be?
Iowa and New Hampshire. I think you're right that the ability to raise money at the grassroots, and Howard Dean really helped pioneer that on the internet. I mean, Bernie Sanders is, you know, he just announced that he got his 3 millionth unique contributor. That's an amazing base for fundraising. I do think if you start losing, it's harder to raise that money. But it does mean that he can stay in the race a lot longer than a Howard Dean would have, for example. And I think he will stay in the race longer. I don't think even if Bernie Sanders gets a bad result in Iowa, even if it's close in New Hampshire, he's going on to the at least through March 1st, and he's got the resources to do it.
Yes.
What about those guys?
So we're at the University of Chicago, which is pretty academic. We're near the Becker Friedman Institute, whose positive people are logical and thoughtful and rational. So no fair answering this by saying 30% of the Republican electorate or likely voters are just plain stupid. Can't do that. So how do you explain the Trump phenomenon? Here's a guy who we've heard him say comes out talking about how rich he is, how smart he is, how everybody else is stupid, they don't make good deals, how Carly Farina looks bad, it's like junior high. Seriously, how can you explain that at an academic institution, the Trump phenomenon?
Well, it's probably not well understood in academic institutions. But actually that is part of his appeal, because I think there's a whole bunch of people in this country, and I'd like to hear from you guys, but there are a whole bunch of people in this country who feel like they've been disadvantaged in the economy. They feel disdained by academic communities and the media elite, and they take great pleasure in Donald Trump thumbing his nose at all those people, and they feel like he's going to fight for them.
30% of the Republican electorate are like that?
Yeah, I think you look at how he's doing. He's done well across the board, and by the way, surprisingly so to me, he does have a base, though, in non-college-educated white folks who've borne the brunt of a lot of the economic changes in these areas. But let's talk to the two who are on the ground. Chip, what do you hear from these Trump voters?
Yeah, the Trump voters are just, I think you touched on a lot of it, but I think a lot of it almost comes down to political correctness. There is a real backlash amongst many conservatives against the notion that you can't say or do so many different things, whether it's in politics or elsewhere. And so they feel that, you know, Donald Trump has sort of taken that glass and just shattered it and said, you know, I'm going to do and say whatever I want, and I'm going to have policies that I want. And, you know, even if people don't agree with what he wants to do, they like that sense of, you know, I'm not going to be cowed by anybody.
Yeah, and I wrote a piece the other day, Jennifer, I want to hear from you, saying about, I do think he is the antithesis of Barack Obama, and he's running in a party that hates Barack Obama with a passion, particularly the activist base of the Republican Party. So, you know, the fact that he is as impulsive, as lacking in deliberation, as cutting and so on as he is, actually plays well in this environment. But Jennifer, what are you hearing?
It's about money and jobs and sealing off that border so that all these, you know, immigrants are not coming in and costing the government money and taking people's jobs. They believe he's a paternal figure. They believe he will take care of them. He will get them health care. He has said, I'm going to take care of everybody. I will do some sort of health care plan, even though he's completely vague. You know, so everything that comes out of his mouth, they see as strength, they see as improving the economy, they see as forceful. He's going to negotiate all these trade deals, he's just going to make everything happen. It's just, you know, we're going to be winning so much, we're going to just be sick of it. It's just, and they really believe that.
And they might get a hat. What's your view?
I think the Sanders and the Trump thing are very similar. If you go to them, there's not many people that go to Bernie Sanders or Trump rallies who make over $100,000 a year. And it is an economically driven movement. I think what Bernie Sanders is saying, is sort of, we're going to have a five-year grain plan, and we're going to be able to do this. It's sort of more out of the American mainstream, in some ways, political mainstream, than what Trump is saying. But there are a lot of really, 23% of the country thinks that we're going in the right direction. There are a lot of very, very frightened, hurting people out there who have been hurting for a long time. And, the last, the trends that have continued, I don't want to get into, President Obama bashing, but if you just look at the stats, these were all trends.
You got that out of your system 4 years ago.
All trends that were, if you just look at the last 7 years, if you were wealthy, you got wealthier for the most part. People who had assets did well. Which is good. That's better than the stock market being at 2,000. And people who owned houses, those houses are probably better than they were. But that's not most people. And those people are really scared. They can't afford college. They can't afford to go to a doctor. They have these health care plans that $5,000 deductible. I mean, you might as well go bankrupt. And it's a very frightened world out there to them.
Yeah, and in that environment, I think a strong man character like Trump, I'll take care of it.
Yeah,
not as I said, not yes we can, yes I can.
Yeah,
has some appeal. I will say, I think the character of the Bernie Sanders, I think it does him a disservice to compare him and his approach to Trump and his support, because his is largely an age-based thing. I mean, he has a huge cadre of supporters among younger Americans, and I suspect he has more supporters than you'd think among upper-income Americans who appreciate his philosophy. So I think it's slightly different, but there's no doubt, and perhaps it's a good place to end on a note of agreement, is that we've had a problem that has been brewing not over one administration or two, but over a long period of time, which is there have been profound changes in our economy. In those changes, a lot of people have been caught in the switches, and there's been great prosperity for some. And for 90% of Americans, there's been a stagnant median wage since 1999. 90% of Americans haven't seen a real wage in 22 years. That's a fundamental challenge for the country, and one hopes that once the circus is over, that there'll be a serious discussion about that between the Republican and Democratic nominees. We've run out of time. It's great to see you all. We hope you'll come to the post-caucus event and a series of others. And Stuart is here this quarter and will be interpreting these events as best as a human being can as the quarter goes along. So thank you very much.
Please join me in thanking.
And thank you. Wait, I should say, let me thank Chip Griffin for joining us from Washington, Jennifer for sneaking away from Iowa as well.
And please join us in thanking our partners in tonight's event, our hosts here, International House, as part of the Global Voices series. It's always great to be here. Thank you very much. Thank you all so much for coming and for your great questions. We look forward to seeing you again soon.
To this, well, we're only going to go after voters in our lane. I think they're walking away from a lot of potential voters. What was Donald Trump's lane 6 months ago? When he was, at 8%. He went out and made a lane, and I think that's how you go out and win.
I think he took over the highway.
Yeah, he took over. And I think there has been this assumption that Donald Trump was unelectable and unnominatable, So therefore, there has been this competition, and this is most noticeable with this Jeb Bush pack, to be the last person standing against Donald Trump, because then you had to win. And I think that's way overthinking it. I think you got one person who's ahead, he's got a bunch of votes. Go get him. And it's about showing that you're a strong candidate.
You know, I hear you, but the last, when you think about who's won the Iowa caucuses, Rick Santorum, Huckabee,
well, Romney won it when it counted.
Robinson, huh?
We won it when it counted for 2 weeks.
Yeah, you had it for 2 weeks. Yeah. It's true. You rented it. But the point is, there is a strong social conservative base that
they're
makes
all conservative.
But is a religiously oriented base that is different than, say, New Hampshire. So it is kind of a but specifically that Trump is competing, he is getting votes across the spectrum. The fact that he's getting votes from there, though, and really pushing Cruz among those. Which is why Ted Cruz is running an abortion ad against Donald Trump in
voters,
Iowa.
Look, you've done this a million times. You know, you sit in a focus group, you test this stuff. I see these Franklin's focus groups. They go, oh, I don't believe it. It doesn't work. That's just not how politics is. It's the way Hemingway said about going bankrupt. It happens slow, gradually, then all at once. And I think that the repeated delivery of information about Donald Trump has been lacking in this race. And I think that most voters really don't know very much about Donald Trump. And I think that when they do, he will not. He is a very unlikely Republican nominee.
It is true that there've been not a steady stream of attacks on him. But he's also repelled those attacks that he's had. He seems to be impervious to that. The audacity of him seems to carry him through.
That's because they've been fighting on his turf. You know, one of the phenomena about Donald Trump is he's not spending much money. So it's sort of like, you know, Saddam. Remember when he challenged George Bush and said, you know, only men fight with on the ground. You know, we don't need planes. It's as if George Bush said, oh, you're right. We'll forget the planes. We'll just fight it out on the ground. You know, no. You challenge Donald Trump. Make him spend money. Will he spend money? He said he's going to spend $2 million a week. He didn't.
One, you cringed at Cruz, and then you tantrumed about Trump. So trying to be alliterative here. But but one interesting thing to me over this weekend, Jennifer, was to see your senator, Chuck Grassley, one of the deans of the Republican Caucus of the United States Senate, at a Trump rally. And apparently, so Cruz is so detested by his Senate colleagues that Grassley decided he wanted to make America great again.
That caught us all off guard to suddenly see Chuck Grassley, our amazingly popular U.S. Senator, up on stage introducing Donald Trump. We just did not see that coming. And so we've got our GOP triad of the most influential Republicans all, and Branstad saying very strongly, don't vote for Cruz, and then Grassley saying very subtly by introducing Donald Trump, he very specifically said, I am not endorsing, and he can still say that with a straight face because he didn't endorse, but he stood there in front of the world, in front of all the TV cameras, and very enthusiastically endorsed him. And then our third member is U.S. Senator Joni Ernst, who is also very popular in Iowa, and she gave that wink, wink, nod, nod for Marco Rubio. So you've got our three most powerful Republicans all like saying, come on, Iowans, don't vote for Ted Cruz. I mean, really strong message, but we'll see if endorsements work. Our Iowa Republicans especially tend not to be bandwagon voters. At least they'll tell you that. They'll say, we make our own decisions. We're not gonna do what, you know, the elected officials tell us to do. We're gonna make up our own minds.
You're not gonna call between Cruz and Trump's, Cruz and Trump, I'm sorry. So I'm not gonna ask you to do that. But I will ask you about third place, because that seems important here, because despite Stewart's frustration with lanes, there is this issue of who might emerge other than Trump and Cruz, mm-hmm. who you won't wince over. And Rubio seems to be the guy who everybody points to. Is he gonna finish third in Iowa?
Likely, and the interesting thing with Rubio is, so the caucuses are about expectations.
Chip, I'm setting up a segue to you, so.
I'll make it short, Chip. The caucuses are about expectations. It's all about the media set expectations for the candidates, and whoever overcomes those and does better than their expectations gets this, you know, huge round of congratulatory news coverage. It's almost guaranteed that Marco Rubio is going to get this very flattering news coverage, even if he finishes 20 points behind the front runners, just because the media has decided that, and some strategists as well, have decided that he is the last mainstream candidate standing. But what Iowa Republicans are saying is, listen, he presented himself to us as both establishment and anti-establishment, and we believe he's a conservative. They really looked him over, and he's very popular across the board with very conservative voters, with evangelical voters, with Tea Party voters, with moderate voters, with even liberal voters. He's very popular across the board, and yet he cannot get out of double digits. And so it'll just be interesting for me to see how people portray if he only comes in a distant third.
Well, one of my questions is that what Jennifer says about Rubio is true, and Chip, you have seen it too. He seems intent on trying to appeal to every faction of the party. He's signified to the social conservatives, took a very strong stance on abortion at the first debates, more conservative than any Republican nominee has ever taken. He identifies as a Tea Party guy, and he is vying to be the candidate of the center-right establishment. Do you get into trouble at some point trying to be appeal to everyone? Do you lose your chance to dominate any of these, or does it all
I think this is all about winning states. I personally think that these first four contests are functional playoffs. Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, Nevada, and that you're going to have to win one of these states in all likelihood to get permission from voters to advance forward. If you're in Florida and you're in second or third place and you lose the first four, why should you advance? It just doesn't make sense to me. So,
well, that would suggest that Rubio could be eliminated under the...
I think you have to win.
Stevens rule.
I don't understand why you compete in states to do okay. I think you shouldn't compete in a state personally if you don't intend to win that state. I was one of the geniuses working for George Bush in 2000 who thought that John McCain would be really hurt by his performance in Iowa. You know, we took a 65-point lead into New Hampshire and lost by 19. That's, you know, you got to really work at that. And so we couldn't have been more wrong. So I think the danger for Rubio, and you can remember this, is the Mo Udall. You know, they keep doing well against Jimmy Carter. You keep doing well, but you don't win. You got to win. To win, you have to win. So that's my question, and I find Rubio a very attractive candidate, and I think he could be the next president of the United States. But he's got to get about the business of winning primaries.
Speaking of Mo Udall, Chip, there's that famous story of him walking into a barber shop when he was running for president in New Hampshire, saying, "I'm Mo Udall, and I'm running for president," and the barber said, "Yeah, we were just laughing about that." It's going to come to you guys, and as Stuart suggests, I think everyone is looking at New Hampshire as the place where the establishment Republican will emerge, that of the group of Rubio, John Kasich, Chris Christie, and Jeb Bush, the winner of that group, even despite the Stevens rule, if they finish second there to Trump, everyone seems to believe Trump's going to win the New Hampshire primary. But the second place finisher will then get to move forward into the process, and the others will fall away. First of all, do you buy that theory?
Well, so, I mean, you have to keep in mind, New Hampshire is not an establishment state on the Republican side. Pat Buchanan got 40% against 41, and he actually won in 96, which a lot of people forget. Ron Paul got in the mid-20s. In New Hampshire. I mean, we have a habit on the Republican side of going for non-establishment candidates. So I think it would be risky to assume that New Hampshire will play that role. That said, there's a large enough portion of the voter base on the Republican side in New Hampshire to give a serious boost to someone who is, you know, perhaps, I don't know what you want to call it, more establishment, more mainstream than Trump or Cruz.
And of those candidates that I mentioned, who is going into this final weekend with, well, it's not the final weekend for you, but who's going in 10 days out? Who has the momentum among that group, and will the Iowa caucuses impact on that?
Yeah, so I mean, I would say just, you know, sort of on the ground, watching what average voters are doing, John Kasich's the one who has some momentum at this point. Now, that may do him a whole hill of no good because he doesn't really have much going on anywhere else. You know, I think if Rubio were to exceed expectations in Iowa, in other words, not just finish third, but, you know, a convincing third, I think that that would be something that would impact his vote total in New Hampshire. But I think the most interesting thing to watch in Iowa is the Trump-Cruz battle, because I think, you know, we've all wondered what is it that's going to cause Trump a problem, and I think if he loses to Cruz in Iowa, I think that spells real danger for him, because his whole campaign strategy, I mean, he's a pugilist, not a policy wonk, and if he can't win in Iowa, how is he going to get Mexico to pay for a wall?
Yeah. Well, yeah, the I mean, I think we all
I
know.
I like that. Write that down.
Did you make that up? Or did you hear another candidate say that?
Good.
That is true. I think the other element is how he personally will process a loss. I mean, this is a guy who starts every presentation off with a recitation of his poll numbers. He loves them, as I said the other day in a piece I wrote, he caresses them. And if he is now not number one, how will he take that? I don't think anybody knows the answer to that. But
It won't be his fault, that we know.
Yes. It'll be Fox News. By the way, does skipping the debate have any impact in either of your states on voters? You suggested before we came out here that you
think president is extraordinarily difficult, and I have the best resume to be president. And they believe her when she says that. They really do. So I hear from every Democratic voter, they're really torn between the two. They could go for either, but some people are voting for the guy who they think has the better vision. Others are going for the woman who they also like very, very much, but think that she's just more presidential.
How did they react in the last few weeks when they started skirmishing? How did Democrats? I felt like there was a reluctance on the part of both campaigns to be on the attack because of what you said, because they're both well liked by Democrats in Iowa, but they've both taken some pretty hard shots.
Except it's been polite. You know, just yesterday in Iowa, one of the reporters asked Bernie Sanders.
Polite by Donald Trump standards or really polite?
Polite by Trump standards. You know, do you think that Hillary Clinton is someone who can't be trusted? And he said, listen, she's a very distinguished woman. I've known her for years, and I respect her. You know, so they have good things to say about each other. It's been a more polite conversation than you might think.
I actually, Stuart, I've been watching that with interest. It seems Bernie has pulled up short in a number of these debates where he really could have gone much more aggressively at Hillary Clinton.
He's very inexperienced. You know, I mean, for all his running for office, he's really had one tough race. And where he ran that three-way against the Democrat and the Republican, and it is true that he wouldn't have won that race if he hadn't made that deal on guns. And as a national figure, compared to Hillary Clinton, I mean, his experience is minimal.
So you think that it was just inexperience, it wasn't a strategy or a expression of his personality that he didn't go after her in the way that a savage consultant like yourself would have advised him?
I think that you always have to be careful when you attack someone that has really high favorables, you know very well. But I think that there is on the emails, there is a logical connection on the trust argument, that you don't have to say you're a crook, that you've done something illegal, but it goes to a tying the same person who takes this money and makes $300,000 a speech and sets up her own email system, and it's sort of like, the rules don't apply to me. I'm special. And I think that there was an argument to be crafted there that he walked away from. Now, there's a bunch of really smart people in that campaign that are doing extraordinarily well. To the degree it was spontaneous or calculated, you know, or calculated makes it sound part of a larger strategy, I have no idea. But to me, it was, it made him look weaker than stronger.
Chip, where are you going here, guys? I need Chip. Chip, in New Hampshire, Bernie is a more familiar figure than he was in Iowa. How much of his advantage there, and he started off well behind there as well, is a function of familiarity with him as a senator from the neighboring state, and how much of it is something more organic to this race?
Yeah, so I don't think very much of Sanders has to do with the neighboring state factor. You know, that happens more with politicians from Massachusetts because we watch a lot of Boston television, read a lot of Boston newspapers. But frankly, not a lot of people in New Hampshire are following Vermont media. So I don't think that's really what it is. I think it's that he's speaking to the desire of a lot of members of the Democratic Party who, you know, really want to engage in a bit more of a fight for the issues they care about. It's really the same dynamic that's driving Trump. You know, people want to be passionate about the issues and they want their candidates to be passionate about the issues.
And how do you, when you go to events in New Hampshire, how do you see the crowds, relative crowds, with between Clinton and Sanders and the way they interact with people?
So the Sanders crowds are more, you know, uniformly enthusiastic, I would say. The Clinton crowds, though, really have the female voters. And I see so many mothers bringing their daughters and saying, you know, take a look up on the stage there, see what you can be. So there, that's a huge element of her support in New Hampshire, and as I suspect it is elsewhere as well. But it's, you know, it's the kind of thing where, you know, moms are taking their daughters out of school to go to these events. So it's two different dynamics, but they both have enthusiasm in their own way.
Do you, Jennifer talked about this this conflict that people have in Iowa in their heads about the virtues of Hillary Clinton as someone who has experience, who's prepared, seems to be central to her message that I know how to navigate the real world. And implicit in that is that Bernie is a well-intentioned kind of gadfly. The Sanders argument is, as Jennifer outlined, one about political revolution and really challenging in a way that Hillary's message is not. Is that how it's playing out there? Is that how voters are perceiving the choice?
To be honest, David, I'm sorry. I only picked up about half of your question there.
Well, answer that half. the question is, how do voters perceive the two of them? What is the choice here? One of the things, the reason I raise that question is because sometimes, I think in the last week or two, the Clinton message has become clearer. But Bernie Sanders' message is crystal clear, which is, you know, it's about the billionaires and it's about the banks and it's about economic fairness and so on. Her message, because she is the master of policy, has been more diffuse. Do you think that her message has become clearer, and is the choice clear to voters in New Hampshire now between sort of the experienced navigator, the tenacious navigator of the system, versus the guy who's going to really challenge the system in a different way?
Oh, yeah, I think that's absolutely crystal clear to the voters. You know, it's one of those things where if what you're looking for is for, you know, someone who has that experience and the steady hand, you're more likely to be with Clinton. But the Sanders folks, you know, they're the idealists, they're the dreamers. And one of the interesting statistics for New Hampshire is that one out of three voters in this year's primary probably weren't eligible to vote in 2008, so just 8 years ago. And a lot of the folks who are coming into New Hampshire are people who are going there for a different way of life, a change. And so Sanders is really speaking to that element of the population.
So the people, when you say they weren't eligible to vote, they aren't necessarily young. They're people who are moving to the state.
Yeah, it's a mix of both of them. You know, I think, and I forget the exact statistic, but I think it's almost half of them were too young, and then the other half have migrated in from elsewhere.
I think this is where Clinton's inevitability argument works against her. Because if you just put yourself in the mindset of a Sanders voter, on the one hand, the Clinton people are saying she's going to win anyway, that we can survive this, that it's sort of out there. So that, to me, gives you a pass to vote for Sanders. If you can vote, it's sort of like that, you know, in Europe, in the first election and the second election, you know, vote your heart in the first and your wallet in the second. Why Very not vote for Sanders if you're a Democrat? Send a message. You don't have to worry about the consequences of it because if Hillary Clinton's going to win anyway, what's it matter?
And you hear that a lot. You hear that about among a lot of Democrats. I had an email from a friend of mine who I grew up with who lives in Pittsburgh, and he said, I think I'm going to vote for, I'll vote for Hillary in the end, but I think I'll vote for Bernie first just to annoy her. And so I think
it's a bigger story.
There's something to that. Not a sense that if she were to lose these races that she'll lose the nomination. There's an overwhelming presumption that she'll win. So you can
I disagree with. But
yeah. You can make a statement by voting for him. So let's talk a little bit about organization in these states, because particularly in Iowa, much is made of organization. Caucuses are not primaries. Caucuses involve a big devotion of time, and it involves standing up in front of your neighbors and declaring yourself in a very public way. So, I've often said that I don't think Barack Obama, as much as popular as he was, had he not started organizing in March of 2007, I'm not sure he would have won the Iowa caucuses. You know, he didn't win by that much. How would you assess the relative state of organizations and enthusiasm right now?
So Bernie just kind of magically draws in these gigantic crowds. And Clinton's people would say, well, we don't know if those are out-of-staters. He tends to go to border communities. He was just in Decorah, and he drew a lot of people.
He did say that about Obama, too, in 2007.
Minnesota and Wisconsin. He's in Council Bluffs. He draws a lot of people from Nebraska. Clinton's people say, when we have our events, we know who these people are. We recognize them. They're Iowans. They're coming. And one interesting thing, so Hillary Clinton has one way of organizing, of getting people in the door and collecting their name and, you know, their email address, is just to get them in the door to begin with. And so she has, you know, Katy Perry coming and singing for her, and Demi Lovato, and she's got Bill Clinton coming and Chelsea, and she gets people in the door that way. But then she has this other strategy that she does where she waits.
Locks the door?
She wades out into the audience, and she has this interesting touch, and you hear a lot of our Democratic voters talking about this quite a bit, where Sanders doesn't. He does the big rally speeches like Trump does and just kind of stands at the podium and does his big bellowing speeches and gets everyone all fired up and then he leaves. Whereas Hillary Clinton, this time, seems very welcoming and accessible to our Democratic voters. I'm hearing that from everyone. In fact, I just got an email 2 days ago from a woman named Janelle. And she said she had gone to one of the Hillary Clinton events. It would happen to be the Katy Perry rock concert. And she was holding up a sign that said, I just completed my 13th round of chemo, just 3 more to go, hear me roar. Mm. And Bill Clinton saw her sign from up on stage, came down and approached her, and she was in tears, and he was hugging and taking photos with her daughter, and then leaves. And then a police officer approaches her and says, Hillary Clinton would like to meet you. Can you please come behind stage? And so she does, and cue the tears again, and she says Hillary just listened to her and talked to her and comforted her. And then she decided to go to the Democratic debate, and one of Hillary Clinton's aides recognized her in the audience and said, oh my gosh, how's radiation going? Hillary will want to talk to you. Please come over here. And sure enough, Hillary recognized her and remembered her name. And then a third time, again, so she's recognized, she goes to a meeting at the historical building of the Hillary Clinton rally, and Hillary sees Janelle and just remembers everything about her and just, you know, very personal. And we're hearing, you know, another woman emailed and said,
she gonna caucus for Hillary?
Oh, I think so. I mean, she's so amazing. And you know, you go around and tell all your friends these stories.
Just a quick program note for those of you who are here for the Donald Trump event with Wounded Warriors. That's actually tomorrow night at Drake University in Des Moines. So my name is Steve Edwards. I'm the executive director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and we are pleased to have you with us to help sort through and understand what is arguably one of the most unpredictable and fascinating primary election seasons, certainly in the last couple of decades, if not further. This is part of our ongoing series of events that we do at the Institute to try and bring leading thinkers and players in politics to share their insights and experiences with us to help us expand and illuminate the public conversation. We also want to make a quick program note for you as it relates to Iowa that on Wednesday, the day after, so a week from today, the day after the Iowa caucuses, we will be doing a similar conversation, a full recap on the results, what happened, and what it means for the race going forward. That will take place at 6 o'clock, a week from tonight, Wednesday night, at Ida Noyes. And we have at the table out in the lobby area a sign up for those of you who haven't yet registered. There's an opportunity for you to do so. It's free and open to the public. Tonight's event is on the record. It is being recorded for our IOP website. You can follow all of our public events and go back and watch the back of your head and the rest of our panelists online. You can search for us via iTunes U. You can also find out more about all of our upcoming public events in our ongoing series on our website at politics.uchicago.edu. As is customary here, we'll take a break in the middle of the conversation about three quarters of the way through to get your questions for our panel tonight. We'll put a microphone in the middle of the room here and ask that you stand up single file to prepare your questions. We, of course, want to remind you that we want questions and we want them to be short and to the point so that we can get to as many of you as possible. So with that, I will step aside and ask you to join me in welcoming to the podium to formally introduce our panel for tonight. Baxter Stein is a second year in the college. He is a public policy major from Westport, Connecticut, very active in the IOP. He's currently an intern with us helping to program events like this. He's also involved in the Maroon Veterans Alliance. Please join me in welcoming Baxter.
Thanks, Steve. All right, so thank you to all of you for coming out tonight. In 5 days, the first caucus goers will head to the precincts in Iowa to start the first contest of the nomination process. During tonight's event, State of the Race, Primary Predictions, our speakers will analyze the race thus far and what to expect going forward into a season, as Steve alluded to, that has been anything but predictable. It is my pleasure to welcome Jennifer Jacobs, Stuart Stevens, David Axelrod, and Chip Griffin. Jennifer Jacobs is an award-winning journalist and currently the chief political reporter for the Des Moines Register. She has been at the forefront of all things Iowa, covering both sides of the high-stakes caucuses on the ground, tracking the candidates' every move. Also with us tonight is Stuart Stevens, one of the nation's most successful political strategists and media consultants. Stevens was lead strategist for the Romney presidential campaign and is currently an IOP fellow. You can find out more about his seminar series and sign up for his office hours at politics.uchicago.edu. On the panel as well is IOP's own director, David Axelrod, who previously served as senior strategist to both Obama presidential campaigns. Lastly, we'll have a special appearance from communications strategist and editor of Primary Digest, Chip Griffin. He will be joining us from Washington via Skype. So there's a lot to unpack in this crazy election cycle. So without any further ado, please join me in welcoming our speakers tonight.
Thanks, Baxter. First of all, let me say, 4 years ago, I spent a lot of my time thinking about, maybe I should do this. I spent a lot of my time thinking about what Stuart was thinking about and trying to figure out how I could thwart that. So it's much more fun to be sitting on the same platform with him, trying to figure out what other people are thinking about. And we're really grateful to you, Stuart, not just for being here, but for being a fellow IOP
great thing here,
this quarter. Chip, good to see you.
It is great to be here.
And appreciate you being with us from Washington. Have you been able to navigate the town? Have those weather wimps taken care of their problems there?
Well, you know, it's nothing compared to what we do in New Hampshire.
Yes. Yes. And Jennifer,
so grateful to you, especially given the timing. It's a real treat to have you here. We won't tell that you slipped out of the state for a few hours to be with us. When was the first time, I want to ask both of you, that a 2016 presidential hopeful visited Iowa? When did you start covering these candidates?
It was Marco Rubio. Can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
It was Marco Rubio, and he came a couple days after the 2012 general election. I think it was 8 days after. And he came for a birthday party for the very popular Governor Branstad, Terry Branstad, and put his footprint in Iowa very, very early.
His bootprint?
Yes, his bootprint.
Yes. Chip, what about you? When did you start seeing candidates up there?
They never stopped visiting.
Yeah. They just, right after the election.
Right after the election, yeah. I mean, it's they always want to lay the groundwork, and sometimes they'll lay it even you know, a cycle or two ahead of when they actually plan on doing something.
The I pulled up this morning as we were thinking about this some quaint clips from a year ago, 11 months ago. Scott Walker grabs lead in New Hampshire, a new poll. Can you explain who Scott Walker is?
Sure. He's the guy that everybody thought would have a huge advantage in Iowa because he was from our neighboring state of Wisconsin. He actually grew up in Iowa. He lived in Iowa until he was 9 years old, the son of a minister. And so everyone thought that he would have a real in with our religious conservative voters in Iowa who dominate our caucus process. And he just had the profile of somebody who was going to soar right to the top. And in fact, he did. As soon as he made his introductory speech in January of last year, he immediately went to the top of our polls and was at the top of our polls for the first half of 2015, and then Trump.
Stuart, yes. And I have another headline here. In early polling, Walker stands apart. Now he stands in Madison, Wisconsin. He's not even, he's running. And then here's another headline. Hillary Clinton, way ahead of opponents in Iowa. This was from—
That's an evergreen.
This is from like late October, early November of 2015. So just to point out the fickleness of this process. Now, if I want to put up a graphic, what happens to Chip? He goes away. Chip, bear with us. We're going to bring you right back. Let's take a look at the national polls right now, and it's probably, we're going to spend less time talking about those because in a way they're irrelevant, but can we put up the, so here's the national, this is an aggregate of national primary polls as of tonight, and you see Donald Trump there at 38%, Ted Cruz at 16, Marco Rubio at 10, and everybody underneath, Dr. Ben Carson, who had his turn on top of the pile there is in fourth. Jeb Bush, who was the early front runner, in fifth. Chris Christie, who was touted right after the last election as the guy to run and then ran into a problem, and all the others. Let's look at the Democratic national polling. And there you have it, Hillary Clinton 15 points ahead of Bernie Sanders. Stuart, are you surprised by that number, that Bernie Sanders has made as strong a bid as he has?
I've spent a lot of, I kind of half live in Vermont, and so I've watched Bernie Sanders, and I will say this, he's the most consistent human being on the planet. We were talking about. He's been saying the same thing for 40 years. I've made a little sport of going to these rallies over in New Hampshire, and I've been to a half dozen Bernie Sanders rallies, a half dozen.
Let's bring Chip back, by the way.
Hillary Clinton rally. And the thing about, you go to a Bernie Sanders rally, I'm sure you've had this experience, people know why they're there. You don't wander into a Bernie Sanders rally. They are there and largely for economic reasons, and I think that it's the economy that's driving this. They feel that there are these big, powerful forces in their lives that have this control over them, and they don't know what to do, and that a lot of them feel like they've done the right things and they haven't worked out. And I think Bernie Sanders really speaks to that in much the same way Donald Trump does, in a different way. But I think it's fascinating how the two sort of come together.
So let's talk to you guys, because you've probably seen more of these candidates than everyone else. What and let's start with Iowa, because it's the first event. We do have, and I don't want to lose Chip. We'll get back to this at some point. But you know, I just mentioned the polls. I mean, it is a stark poll where Sanders has just been on an upward skein in Iowa. Where do you think the race is now?
Well, there's definitely a sense in Iowa that we're witnessing history, that we could be seeing, to use Bernie's word, a revolution on both sides, that it is about pocketbook issues, like Stuart said. It's about people feeling like they cannot keep ahead of their bills and feeling like, you know, it's the low wages and working millions of hours and not getting ahead. And it's the same thing on Trump's side. They feel like they're witnessing a revolution on that side, and it's a revolution for which no one has any idea what the consequences are. But people do feel a sense that, you know, this is coming. So, you know, people see in Bernie Sanders the opposite of what they see in Hillary Clinton in some ways. Democratic voters in Iowa adore Hillary Clinton. She has very high favorability ratings, so don't get me wrong. They like both Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton, but they see in Bernie Sanders as somebody who is authentic. When he says, you know, Hillary Clinton just doesn't pass the laugh test when she says that she can take down Wall Street, when she took all these speaking fees from Goldman Sachs, or, you know, how can she say she has good judgment when she voted for the Iraq War in 2002, which was one of the most significant foreign policy decisions of her career and mine. And so, and voters just nod at that and respond to just about everything Bernie says, but then they look at Hillary and they say, you know, they believe her argument. Her closing argument is the world is a very complex place. So it's like, you know, this person-by-person connection that is being made.
Is this different than what you saw in 2008?
She did wade into the crowd in 2008, but it seemed like people didn't feel like they were making that personal connection. And I hear, the Janelle story is kind of extreme, but I hear that from so many people. They feel like Hillary Clinton is their friend. They feel like she recognizes them, she knows them, she's gone. One woman said she had a house party, and Hillary Clinton came, and they thought she would stay for half an hour. She stayed for 4 hours talking at the kitchen table with his family.
Sounds like a Saturday Night Live skit, actually. The fact that Bernie Sanders gives his speech and goes, I mean, he was here. I don't know if any of you were here when he was here, but it was quite a scene and quite a crowd. And he, but on the way in, we taped a podcast with him. And at the end, I said, well, you know, you're kind of an unlikely rock star, you know. And he said, don't get me going on those selfies. Because I don't want to talk about those selfies. Everybody wants a selfie. And it was clear that, you know, that aspect of campaigning was not his thing. She seems to be...
She is embracing it this time. And she has also said, I can't stand selfies. Everyone wants to do it. And she said, the reason she doesn't like them is because she doesn't get a chance to talk to voters. You just have to freeze and, you know, snap a photo, and then she doesn't get to actually have a conversation.
But in terms of the level of organization, which is important in the caucuses, who has the better organization in Iowa?
Equal, as far as I can tell. Bernie Sanders has tons of people coming in from out of state who are, you know, organizing means making phone calls. It's the one-on-one contact. People, volunteers who come into the offices and make phone calls to their fellow Iowans, or go knock on doors, or, you know, go distribute flyers and things like that. It is really hard for me to tell who has a better organization. I'm going to say they're about equal. The trick for Bernie Sanders is that he has a lot of young people who support him, and so his support is concentrated in our three college towns. And so the way the Iowa caucuses work, as you probably know, it's not just a head count. It's not very democratic. It's actually, you go and stand in a corner, and then you get a certain number of delegates based on, you know, the number of people in your room. And Bernie has an excess of support in these college towns, and there's just a limited number of delegates that he can win, whereas in some of the smaller areas, he doesn't have as much support, and those are really delegate-rich areas. So even though maybe Bernie Sanders has, 50,000 supporters, he might not get as many delegates as Hillary Clinton because her support is spread more around the state. So it's...
Now, they're trying to remedy that by busing their kids back to shuttling their kids back to their hometowns to vote. How effective, has that ever been done effectively before?
That's really tricky, and you've got college students who have to go to class the next day. Our caucuses are on a Monday night. Last cycle, they fell during our Christmas holidays, and so students were home with their families anyway. They're in their hometowns anyway. This time, they're away at school. And so Bernie Sanders is renting vans and buses and getting cars and trying to get these college students to go back to their hometowns to balance out his vote so that he captures all those delegates. It is really, really hard to get students to decide to go to the next bar down the street, much less to go, all the way back to their hometown on a maybe cold and snowy night when they've got classes the next day and other things going on. But we'll see. We'll see.
Kegs in the van, is that a or free Ben and Jerry's ice cream? Chip, what about in New Hampshire? What's the how would you assess on the Democratic side? Because we're going to get to the Republican side in a second. The level of organization of these candidates, and how important is that in what is a primary where you don't have to do the things, run through the hoops you have to in a caucus?
Yeah, we have a process that people can actually understand here.
This is why we have Chip coming in on video, because we didn't want to put them together.
Yes.
We thought there'd be some regional tension here.
Although I will give credit to Iowa, because this time I think Iowa could have a major impact on how New Hampshire votes, but we can get to that at some other point. Organizationally, the two campaigns are both strong in New Hampshire, but very different. The Clinton campaign is really more of a professional, top-down organizational structure, lots of actual offices, paid staff, that sort of thing. And the Sanders campaign is more traditional, democratic, grassroots organizing, sort of the labor union types that just get together and seem to be loosely coordinated with the campaign, but it's not clear to me exactly how well the mothership is really aware of and controlling it.
And should I extrapolate from that you think the Clinton campaign has a more effective organization?
I would say that they have a more traditionally effective organization, but this isn't a traditional year, and so maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe all of the lessons that we've learned in the past about how to organize a campaign, how to run a campaign is totally different. I mean, if you had suggested to me, 6 months ago, a year ago, that Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump would refuse the opportunity to debate right before the caucus and primaries, you'd be thought you were out of your mind. So it's very different than anything we've ever seen before.
Yeah.
Right. So if Hillary Clinton and Ted Cruz win Iowa, the conventional wisdom about organization holds, because Ted Cruz has been doing the grind also. But if Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump wins, it throws that whole model out the window. It really raises questions about the Iowa model.
Chip, you said that you thought the caucuses would impact on the New Hampshire primary. Is that true on both sides? Would you say it'll have an impact on the Democratic side? I'm just trying to keep this an orderly Democratic conversation and moving on to the Republican thing.
Sure, yeah, I think it has an impact on both sides. On the Democratic side, I think it's hard to see Bernie not winning in New Hampshire at this point. I mean, it's not going to be a 2-1 victory like some of the polls suggest, but it would take some dramatic development over the next 12, 13 days for him not to win. However, I think that the Iowa result, will affect the margin in New Hampshire on the Democratic side.
So if Bernie does better in Iowa, it will enlarge his margin. I've heard that from a number of people inside his camp. They believe that, and they believe if she wins in Iowa, it'll narrow the race in New Hampshire, which isn't always the way it is. Sometimes New Hampshire plays a contrarian role.
Right.
As I learned painfully in 2008. We went in 5 days out, 11 points up in New Hampshire, and we left with a hearty handshake in the home game, and Hillary Clinton won the primary. Let's move on to the Republican picture, and again, let's start with New Hampshire. I'm sorry, with Iowa. Here we go. Chip, we just pushed you out of the way for a while.
The audience will appreciate that.
We're going to bring you back by popular demand in a second. So here you have Donald Trump and Ted Cruz in a virtual tie. This is a poll of polls. Now, I should point out that the much heralded Des Moines Register poll comes out this weekend, right? The final Des Moines Register poll, and it's been quite accurate historically.
Our pollster, Ann Seltzer, has predicted the caucus winner every cycle that she's been doing this, and that's since 1988.
Yeah. So, a little plug for the Des Moines Register right there. But here you see essentially a two-person race between Trump and Cruz. Let's get Chip back here. The dynamics of this race have been a little crazy, as everything involved in the Republican race has since Donald Trump entered in June. A few weeks ago, when I spoke to Republicans, they felt, and Stuart, you should chime in on this because you talk to these guys all the time, pretty confident that Cruz was going to win the Iowa caucuses, that he had so thoroughly organized the evangelicals, the social conservatives, he had enough Tea Party support, and he was so rigorously organized that he would win. Has the chatter on the ground changed in the last few, along with the polling in the last few days?
Well, Ted Cruz, I do think it's a very tight race, and you can tell me if you disagree, but I do think it's very, very close. There's some polls out there that show it's not close, and I think I'm skeptical of those polls. But with Ted Cruz, he has more challenges than any, you know, front runner I can think of. You know, he's got two past Iowa caucus winners to compete against, Mike Huckabee and Rick Santorum.
Both of whom have big appeal to social conservatives.
Yes, exactly. Then he's got Ben Carson to deal with, who also is taking a chunk of the evangelical vote. He's in double digits in Iowa. He's got the ethanol lobby, our renewable fuels lobby, absolutely just hammering him because they don't like his stance on renewable fuels.
And the governor's jumped on
that. The governor of our state came out and said, do not vote for Ted Cruz. I mean, he broke his pledge to stay neutral because he was so alarmed at what message it would send if Iowa gives the victory to somebody who's so opposed to renewable fuels, which is, you know, it's our ag economy is very much tied to renewable fuels, and so our governor truly feels like it would be damaging to our state. And then he's got the Trump phenomenon. So, I mean, Ted Cruz just has it just incoming from all directions, so if he still wins the Iowa caucus, I think that sends a pretty strong message that he overcame a lot and still won. But
Stuart,
I refuse to feel sorry for Ted Cruz. I'm sorry.
Well, you
not even Jennifer can make me feel sorry for Ted Cruz.
But you've been even harsher in your critique of Donald Trump. I saw a poll in the last couple of days that showed Trump only six points behind Cruz among evangelical voters. How does Donald Trump, as you and I have talked about, how does a guy who's a casino operator, married three times, used to be, ardently pro-choice, and there are a whole range of other things here.
Well,
how is he competing with Ted Cruz for the evangelical?
Hell if I know. I think the greatest mystery to me in this race is how is it that it's close to the caucuses, close to New Hampshire, and no Republican campaign has managed to get it together to have a sustained effort against Donald Trump. And I think
that's not true. Rick Perry went after him.
A sustained.
Scott Walker took some shots at him.
Sustained effort.
I'm trying to make a point.
And I think one of the things that I just keep hearing, which I think is absolutely the wrong way to look at politics, is this obsession this cycle with lanes. I feel like we're in this giant highway project. Everybody says, well, he's in this lane, he's in that lane. I don't think that the Iowa Republican electorate is that diverse. We're not talking about New York City where they're teaching 27 languages in schools and you have this. They all vote the same way 99% come November. They all vote for Branstad. This is not a wildly diverse group of people. And I think that when candidates and campaigns have gotten into
voters in Iowa are not going to like that.
I'm just getting mixed messages. I follow a lot of activists in Iowa on Twitter, and I read their Facebook messages and things like that. And today, especially, people were saying, okay, this is a turning point for me. This is childish. This is just a little too erratic for me. It may be even unstable. A few people said he committed to doing this debate, and now he's backing out. If we can't trust him to keep commitments, I mean, what on earth? And, you know, other people say, you know, he stepped all over his immigration message that, you know, the day he said he probably wouldn't come to the debate. He was supposed to be doing this big event in Marshalltown, which is one of our towns that has a big problem with illegal immigration, and with this sheriff, Joe Arpaio. It was supposed to be this big immigration day, and he stepped on that news to go off in this other direction, and people are just saying, you know, he's just making our heads spin. And a few people emailed and said, you know, if he's that erratic, do I trust him to be the commander-in-chief and in charge of our kids going away to war? Mm.
Now, that was a citizen who did that. Was that Ted Cruz who emailed?
Regular voter.
Chip, do you think that this has any impact on people's assessment of him? Fox News has a pretty strong foothold in the Republican electorate.
Yeah, they absolutely do. You know, look, I think that it has to be combined with a loss in Iowa. I think if he wins Iowa, it becomes irrelevant. So I don't think it has a direct impact on New Hampshire. But if it was paired with that loss, that I think could be the 1-2 punch that takes him out.
Stuart, your suggestion is that I am of the mind that if Trump wins Iowa now, after Cruz had been heralded for so long as the guy who was going to win Iowa, if Trump wins Iowa and he goes on and wins a good victory in New Hampshire, I think he's going to be hard to stop. I think it's going to be hard to stop.
Well, look, you know, my success in the Trump prediction business is worse than his bankruptcies. I think every time that we say this time it's different, be it politics or finance or sports, it turns out not to be different. You know, it's 99 and the NASDAQ doesn't go to 10,000. It's 2007 and house prices don't keep going up. I think that, just as in The Big Short, it's easier to estimate what will happen than when it'll happen. And Donald Trump as a nominee of the Republican Party would be an utter disaster. You would lose the Senate, it would split the party. It would be a very self-destructive.
Yeah, that's a different question, though, than whether he'll be the nominee of the Republican Party.
I just think that people ultimately tend to do what's in their best interest. And I think that he is so different than anyone else who's winning these elections that it would be very inconsistent.
Let me just read you some numbers from the Wall Street Journal NBC poll that just came out. Among Republicans, would you find, as the Republican candidate for president, acceptable or unacceptable? Donald Trump, 65% said they would accept him. Cruz, 66. Rubio, 67. Ben Carson, 62. Now, Jeb Bush was at 52, and who started off as the front runner in this race. The Trump number is noteworthy, but so is the Bush number. Let's just take 1 minute on what the heck happened to Jeb Bush. Chip, you want to chime in on that?
Yes, I mean, you know, Jeb just has never really been able to generate a group of supporters that are actually excited about him. And it's hard to be...
Even with the exclamation point?
Even with the exclamation point. I mean, the only thing I can say in Jeb's favor at this point is that he has cultivated a group of curious voters in the last couple of weeks in New Hampshire, people who are talking about him and wondering about him, but that's a far cry from supporting him. And you know, if you don't have any passion for your candidacy from your supporters, or, I mean... Frankly, I mean, the Trump low energy thing seems on the mark. He doesn't seem all that visibly passionate himself. It's hard to imagine that person becoming president.
The Bush campaign and the Bush Super PAC have spent more money in Iowa than any other campaign. Has it had any perceptible impact there?
I think Rubio's close, isn't he? Rubio and his Super PACs have been almost matched, I think. Bright to Rise and Jeb together are at 58, and Rubio's people are combined just below that. But no, it hasn't had much of an impact for either of them, either Jeb Bush or Marco Rubio. It's just, I don't think it's an establishment year. And I think even though Marco Rubio portrays himself as somebody who can apply to, or, you know, can appeal to everybody, it's just not catching fire there.
It's an interesting thing because, as Stuart pointed out, Donald Trump, until the last few weeks, has spent virtually nothing. In fact, I'm of the opinion that he was making money on the campaign by leasing his plane to himself. And yet he's dominated the race since he got in June. And I mean, this is bad for business too. I'm retired. But you're still in the business, man. How are you going to explain this?
Just on the Jeb thing. I think the.
And why don't you guys start queuing up for questions?
Yeah, and I like Jeb Bush a lot. I'd be very comfortable with Jeb Bush as president. I think that the biggest mistake personally that they've made is talking about what he did as Florida. Because I know just from experience in Romney world, whenever we looked at this, talking about what he did in Massachusetts, there was very limited appeal and that to hear about it versus what you would do as president. So to me, it's trying to sell like an iPhone 7 by showing someone a flip phone. You know, you say, well, like the world's best flip phone, but what does it have to do with your ability to produce a great phone? And I think that that has kept him one foot in the past instead of the future. A strategic mistake.
Yeah, I think on Bush, I think that, as I've written about and I've said, I think that there is an instinct on the part of Republican voters to pick the candidate who has the qualities that they see lacking in President Obama. Mm-hmm. That it's the opposite. And Jeb Bush, frankly, is he has some of the same idiosyncrasies. In terms of, you know, he got asked, other candidates said they were going to rip up the Iran treaty. Bush said, well, first I'm going to appoint my cabinet, then I'm going to talk to my allies and so on. And which is the question, that's sort of the answer you want a president to give, but not necessarily the one Republican Party primary voters want to hear from their nominee. Two more numbers I want to read, and then I'll take the question. On this NBC poll, the best chance to win, Trump 56, Cruz 17. And as you know, these things do tend to build on themselves. So that's a significant number. But who would bring change? Trump 51, Cruz was second at 17. This is nationwide. The only place where Cruz beat Trump was on best personality, actually. So kind of unusual, but anyway, questions.
So my question will be about electability. So first, on the Republican side, do anyone care about electability? Because Cruz and Trump seem like the most unelectable Republicans out there at the field right now. And on the Democrat side, is the Sanders surge a bit fueled by Democrats looking at Republican race with glee, saying that we will beat this guy even if we pull someone out of the street and make them a Democrat? So who cares about electability and to what extent?
Well, you know, Jack Drummond, who is a journalist of a certain wonderful journalist, used to say that those candidates that depend on electability seldom are, which I always thought was a great way to put it. I think that you tend to think whoever you're for can win, or you wouldn't be for the most part. It's a home team advantage. I mean, what team do you think, okay, I'm for this team, particularly at the beginning of the season, you know, everybody thinks the Cubs are going to go to the Super, are going to go to the all the way to the.
I think they are
the World actually. Series. So, I think that you have this phenomenon that the two candidates, a leading Republican Party, both of whom I think would lose the Senate with them, and I think if the party nominates either one. Will lose.
The fact is that's happened before in history. I mean, you nominated Barry Goldwater. We nominated George McGovern.
Look, if the party has to go through that, the party has to go through that. I tend to think it won't do that, if for no other reason than the first instinct of politics is to hold on to what you have. The second is to get more. And this, you have the Senate now, and you have all these Senate races. And you know, there's only one senator in 2012 who was a Republican who was elected in a tight race where in a state that Mitt Romney lost, and that was in Nevada with Heller, and he won by 0.03% in a three-way. So if you don't have a Republican candidate who's winning Ohio, who's at least doing well in Pennsylvania, who's winning Florida, you're going to lose the Senate. They just can't get there with the math.
I can tell you what Republican Iowa Republicans who support Trump say, and that is they do believe that Trump is very, very electable, and he has proven that when he went after Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton on the whole, you know, the sexual trysts thing. They feel like he really shut her down on that and showed that he can just be a steamroller who crushes everything in his past. In his path. So I do think that Republicans who back Trump think that he can crush anyone.
And in terms of the Democratic Party, I think Stuart raised a really good point earlier, which is I think that people think they can have their cake and eat it too, that Bernie Sanders isn't going to be the nominee of the party. They can vote for him, and ultimately Hillary will prevail, and that she may be the most, you know, fortified for a general.
And we should know, this is an amazing moment. You know, I find the Sanders thing in many ways more fascinating than the Trump thing, because I think it's more meaningful, ultimately, I think. We'll see. But Sanders beats everybody. He does better against all the Republicans than Hillary Clinton. And if we just said that an obscure socialist from a tiny state was going to do that.
Or even a well-known socialist.
That's a pretty amazing moment.
Yeah, well, let me just say, I like Bernie Sanders, and I think he's run a spectacular campaign. Right. But no one's really touched him. I mean, and no one's touched him for a reason. If the Republican Party thought Bernie Sanders was a bigger threat, they wouldn't be running ads in Iowa that seemed calculated to try and get liberal voters to go to vote for Bernie Sanders, which is what's happening right now. You mentioned the Cubs. The Ricketts family has a super PAC. They're running ads in Iowa that flay Bernie for being for government-run health care and taxes on the rich and going after Wall Street. Well, I don't think that's going to hurt them in the caucuses, and I don't think they think so either. Yes, next question.
Thank you. I have a question about the role media could play in straightening out the facts. And I did a little bit of research on the illegal immigration in the United States, and I found that what Trump has said in his speech is very ill-timed and also unfounded, because you know, the Mexican immigrants peaked in 2007, and there was a dramatic demographic shift in Mexico, and there were far fewer Mexicans, you know, trying to cross the border. And also we see that in